It is my great pleasure to introduce you to Julie Salinger and Ashley Boyd, two of our clinical social workers from the Breast Oncology Center and Adult Survivorship Program. Today, they're here to talk with you about facing forward after active treatment. At the end of the presentation, there will be time for questions and answers. Please feel free to type in your questions during the presentation and they'll be addressed at the end. Without further ado, here are two wonderful clinicians.
Hi, everybody. My colleague Ashley Boyd and I are pleased to be with you today to discuss life after treatment for breast cancer. As you just heard, my name is Julie Salinger, and I'm a clinical social worker at Dana-Farber, working exclusively with breast cancer patients and their families. While I work with breast cancer patients at all stages of this disease, our focus today is on patients whose disease is curable and treatment comes with a beginning, a middle, and an end. My colleague, Ashley, specializes in survivorship, among other areas, and has recently taken over the reins of Dana-Farber's long-standing support group, Facing Forward After Breast Cancer. Together, we are uniquely positioned to help you develop realistic expectations for your recovery. Indeed, to acknowledge that you are in recovery, which requires patience, both on your part and by those who care for you. So first of all, what do we mean by, quote, after treatment? Treatment for curable breast cancer usually includes some or all of the following: surgery, chemotherapy, either before or after surgery, radiation, antibody and hormonal treatments. Today, we're focused on those who have completed surgery, chemo, and radiation. Many of you remain on antibody and hormonal treatments and will for some time. We assume your active treatment is over and you are coming to clinic visits less frequently and are considered by your medical teams, your families, and friends to be cancer-free. In theory, this might be a joyful time. In practice, it might be something entirely different. Ashley, let's get started.
So many of you may be here. Your active treatment is over. You made it through. You may feel proud of your strengths that you never knew you even had. You might feel relief or excitement that your active treatment is done. Many times you expect and hope to feel nothing but complete joy and relief when you complete treatment. But you might also feel some internal or external pressure that you should be ready to, quote, move on, and you might just not be there yet. It's okay to take both time to celebrate and reflect, but also acknowledge that there's time to think, or sometimes overthink, worry, wonder, and take all that has changed for you in. So your physical changes, emotional changes, personal changes, financial changes. It's good to reflect on those as well. Many times you might be wondering, when will I get back to normal? Will I ever get back to normal? What does it even mean to get back to normal? So this might be happening while those around you congratulate you for finishing treatment and expect that it's over and it's time to move on. Your friends and family might be relieved, ready to celebrate, but are you? It might be surprising to those seemingly helpful friends and family that the answer is nope, no way, no. It's not a shock to you that this transition feels more difficult than anticipated. I imagine that's why you're listening to this presentation today. For some of you, this time might feel even more challenging than treatment itself. So let's explore some of the reasons why. So Julie's going to start us off with some of these reasons.
So we've learned already that the first year or so after treatment ends can be physically and emotionally challenging. And in fact, and I'm going to repeat this, patients may find the end of active treatment for breast cancer more difficult physically and emotionally than the treatment process itself. So let's look at recent history. First, let's step back from this slide and take a look at all the words on this slide. We have made every mistake in the world in terms of PowerPoint presentations by putting way too much on this slide, but that's done on purpose. We want to send you a pictorial representation of how much has gone on over the last year or so. Could be 18 months, could be 6 months. It's different for everyone. But 6 to 12 months ago, you were diagnosed with breast cancer. The news may have followed a harrowing few weeks of uncertainty as you waited for final test results, managed the shock of your diagnosis, and initiated a treatment plan. Work schedules may have changed. Childcare needs arose. Phone calls, emails, text messages to friends and family may have dominated your days. Some of you may have gone and visited fertility clinics to talk about future childbearing. Insurance issues may have arisen, financial concerns, fear of losing your job, conversations with your workplace, your children's schools, navigation of complicated family dynamics. If you had complicated dynamics before the diagnosis, they're sure not going to be any better during the diagnosis. So that's where you've been. And then treatment began. Chemo, surgery, radiation, hormonal treatment, or all of the above. All of these things ruled the day for many months. You were busy and focused and fighting until now.
So let's talk a little bit about what might be happening for you now. So the regularity and the familiarity of your clinic visits has most likely ended. You might be coming back for follow-up appointments, but you're not on that regular schedule where you were coming in and seeing the same nurses, doctors, clinic assistants, social workers, and some of the other patients that you might have seen as part of your weekly or even sometimes daily support system. You were busy managing the disease, and now that's coming to an end, and that can feel very vulnerable, and you might feel a little bit a sense of a loss of control, you know, sort of what's going to happen to me now, especially if it feels like no one's watching over me. That safety net could feel like it really has fallen away, and a question that you might be thinking about right now and weighing heavy on your mind is, what happens if my cancer recurs? So we're going to start our conversation today about some of the symptoms that you might be experiencing and giving you some tools to address these. Obviously, we couldn't fit everything into this presentation, but we're going to try to cover as much as we can. The first thing we're going to talk about is your physical recovery. So this is hard because you've gone through your treatment and you may no longer feel like you trust your body. You might not look or feel like yourself. You might feel exhausted, but you can't sleep. You might be worried about pain or experiencing some side effects. You might have no hair. You might have gained or lost 15 pounds, which you weren't expecting. You might have scars or burns. You know, you sort of might have neuropathy or maybe lymphedema or be worried about having both of those side effects. You may have experienced early menopause or have already gone through menopause and have some physical effects from that, which can include hot flashes, vaginal dryness. And it's important that, you know, we mention all of these potential side effects and physical symptoms that you might be experiencing. And it's also important that we focus on the realistic expectations for your physical recovery and that what might work for you might not work for others. I also just want to mention that talking to your doctor about establishing a survivorship care plan is crucial. So a survivorship care plan is a record of your treatment history and a plan for checkups, follow-up testing, and strategies for dealing with some of these long-term side effects as a result of either your treatment or your diagnosis. So I'm going to start by giving you a few tools for managing physical symptoms in particular. The first thing I want to talk about is exercise, which I know what you're thinking. We don't want to talk about exercise. I'm tired. This is the last thing I want to do or talk about. It feels a little bit counterintuitive, but I think it's important that we start with exercise because this is just a really important tool that you can use in feeling better. So we know that exercise can help reduce some of your side effects from treatment, including fatigue, which I know seems impossible, that if you're tired, exercising will help you feel less tired, but studies have shown that that actually can help. It can also help with the neuropathy we were talking about, your range of motion, weakness, and obviously addressing any weight gain that you're feeling uncomfortable with. I just want to mention that it's important to carefully consider many factors before you start an exercise routine, and we know that getting started can sometimes be the hardest part. The first thing is making sure that you're talking with your medical team about any side effects and anything that might not be safe for you to do in terms of an exercise plan, so making sure you're touching base. Setting some clear goals for yourself and starting small. You know, you might not be able to do everything that you used to be able to do. You know, maybe starting small by just taking a walk might work best for you. Be patient and flexible with yourself. We know that this is hard. It could be that you used to be able to run marathons and you were a competitive athlete, and now you're just not really able to do that. So try to be gentle with yourself and know that your body has changed, and that's okay if you can't do what you used to be able to do. Also, just noticing when your energy levels are higher. So if you're finding that the afternoon you're really feeling like you want to take a nap and that's not a good time to exercise, maybe try exercising in the morning and seeing if that helps increase your energy levels. And lastly, just asking for help. So you could meet with a personal trainer or an exercise psychologist, and they can help with thinking through what might work for you in terms of an exercise plan. And additionally, maybe trying something new. You know, you never know what might feel good at this point. And as long as you're being clear and talking with your team, this could be something that you could try that might be helpful. Okay, so the next topic I want to talk about is nutrition. So I just want to acknowledge again that nutrition's a tricky topic. I'm certainly not a nutritionist, and today I'm just going to sort of give you a general overview discussing nutrition and choices around food. So this one's really hard, and I just want to acknowledge that because patients tend to focus and can often blame themselves based on this thought that their diet might have contributed to their cancer. And I really want to try to move away from that and just sort of talk about, you know, diet in general. So we know that having a balanced diet is important for many reasons, and today we're just going to talk about some general thoughts regarding nutrition. And I want to encourage anyone with specific questions to reach out to a professional who can help you make these changes based on your particular needs and your particular body. So just a caveat there that that's really important, and we will talk about how to access some of those resources a little bit later in the presentation. So just generally, I want to mention that, you know, when you focus on nutrition, we really talk about moderation, sort of eating the rainbow, meaning focusing on eating lots of fresh fruits and veggies, and avoiding sort of these hype or fad diets unless you discuss those with your team. So just encouraging you to really reach out and ask questions about foods that you feel, you know, you might want to avoid or what might be good for you. It's really important to touch base with your team about that. So instead of really focusing on diet, we really encourage you to find ways that food can have an impact on your recovery in a positive way and what might work for you without sort of becoming obsessive or worrying about this a lot. We know that this is a big part of your physical recovery and that sometimes that weight loss or gain can be really uncomfortable. We're going to discuss this a little bit more in a future slide about changes in self-image, but nutrition can play a role in this part of your recovery. So now I'm going to switch it back to Julie, and she's going to start talking a little bit more about emotional symptoms and some tools for helping with emotional recovery.
So we have transitioned from action to what? To reflection. There's less time to sit, and there's more time, I'm sorry, to sit and think, and there's more time to reflect on what just happened. And that can be very difficult emotionally. The defenses that you've had to get you through the last year or so can weaken, and there's more time to ponder and worry about what will happen. And the safety net, as we've said, feels like it's gone. So this can lead to more anxiety, to more depression, and it's a concern to many folks. It's very normal to feel this. It's very normal to worry. And it's really important to accept the fact that this is a part of the cancer experience, is to go through this period. Anxiety and depression come in different forms, and it's important for you to sort of take note of where you are, where you've been, and to notice where it's going, because sometimes people at this point in the process need some extra help. And it's important to be communicative and to talk with your providers about your anxiety, about your depression, so that we can help you, because there are many different ways of helping. We're going to talk about some of them, but there's also the kinds of things that are more medically related, like medication, and we're not going to spend much time today talking about that, but that is something that often happens at this point in time, is that it's that patients need to have some medication to help with anxiety and depression for some period of time. Another thing that can happen that's very upsetting to people is that their cognitive changes. There can be word-finding issues. There can be memory issues. And this is something that you've probably heard as called chemo brain, which we actually now call cancer brain, because it can occur in patients that haven't had chemo at all, just had cancer and had perhaps radiation and surgery or radiation and antibodies and hormonal treatment and so forth, not just chemo. But it's something that is common for really most people who've been through cancer treatment. And it's usually temporary, and over time it gets better. If it feels as if it's not getting better, and by that I mean a year from now, a year from the time you finish treatment, you really don't see any change or it worsens, it's really important to tell your team about it, because it's always a good idea to get extra help. Sometimes people will learn compensatory strategies for some of the things that are a bother to them, like memory and so forth, or organization, that kind of thing. So it's something for you to keep in mind, but also to feel really confident about. Relationships can be really at a difficult point right now, because people can feel that the people you love have been there for you and you feel guilty about it. They haven't been there for you and you're angry about it. All sorts of things can happen with relationships. And it becomes very emotional and difficult. And often it's a time where people need couples counseling. And that's something to talk with, if you have a social worker about that. But also to keep in mind that it may be a good time to do some work. But also waiting it out for a while is a good idea, because things can get better. Body image and sexual health is something we're going to talk about in more detail. But obviously there's a big upheaval at this time, and it takes a long time for this to work its way out, and it's very emotional. People feel angry, and angry is a difficult emotion. Sometimes people don't want to feel anger. They feel that a negative emotion is a really bad thing to have, but if you feel angry, you feel angry, and it's okay. The important part is to talk about it, to have a place where you can express it so that you can work through it. Anniversaries start to occur after you finish treatment. So you start to come up to the first time that you felt a lump, or that the first time that your first anniversary of the diagnosis, or the loss of a breast. Or you can start having first birthdays and first Christmases and so forth, whatever you celebrate, after this occurs, and things really feel different. And what's important is to acknowledge that this is real. Anniversaries are real. We don't really understand why it happens, but people will often say, you know, I felt really terrible for a few weeks, and then I realized this is the anniversary of my diagnosis. I wish I'd recognized that at the time, because I could mark it in a way and accept that it's okay to feel the way I do. Another thing that can happen is that people can actually feel some post-traumatic stress. which includes increased anxiety, depression, sleeplessness, bad dreams, hopelessness, a stronger startle response. Going through a cancer diagnosis can be very traumatic for some people, especially for people who have had earlier traumas, because it can trigger the old kinds of traumatic responses that you've had. So it's important to be mindful of this and to talk to someone about it. This is also a time where people start to think about, how do I make a meaning out of what's happened to me? And that's an emotional thing. What do I do with what happened to me? Is this a positive thing? Is this a negative thing? Why did it happen? Did I deserve it in some way? Is there something I did that brought this on? As we discussed a little earlier, as Ashley discussed, is it something that I ate? Was it that I had a bad diet or I didn't exercise? And it's a time where you're trying to put this cancer diagnosis in its place. And, you know, the good news and the bad news is there's never a real explanation. And that's hard, because sometimes it's really easier for people to have an explanation. It feels more settled. It feels more secure. But it just doesn't always work that way, and it usually doesn't. And just recognizing that you're thinking it through. How is this going to be incorporated into my life? What does this really mean for me? It's an emotional time, but it's a time where you can do the reflection that you now have time to do. And another strong emotion that comes through is for people is guilt. It's guilt over not bouncing back quickly, because people around you may be expecting you to. And it's also guilt over what you might feel you've put your family through. You've put your children through, perhaps, and you wonder, why did I do this to my kids? How could I have made them sort of be front and center with the potential of losing a parent? That can be very guilt-provoking, and that's a really important thing to talk about. Some of the tools that we talk about with people for managing these emotions is, as we said, seeking help from a professional. Group support. There are groups. We have a group here, Facing Forward After Breast Cancer, but there are other groups. As you can see from this cartoon, thinking positive is something that we're all encouraged to do. And so getting help to help you learn how to think positive, but also allow yourself to think about the scary things, is a really important part for actually working through these difficult emotions. It's easier at times to try to please others who want you to be happy. But it's also important to be honest with yourself. Looking at what is most feared can actually help you move through those fears better than pushing them away. When you push them away, you actually tend to trip over them. It's like pushing something under a rug. You don't know where it's going to pop up, and you tend to trip over it. So telling yourself it's okay to talk about these things. Sometimes we refer to positive thinking as the tyranny of positive thinking, because it is sort of tyrannical. It's important. What I often hear from patients is, well, I think positively because if I don't, I'm going to be responsible for my cancer growing or recurring. And we wish, in a way, that our thoughts had that much power. Because if they did have that much power, we would have figured out a way to manage cancer or even cure it long ago. But unfortunately, our thoughts don't have that much power. They do have power to have us live in a comfortable way and have a good quality of life. So we certainly don't want people to be stuck in a negative cycle of thinking, because that's not a happy way to live. But at the same time, it's really important to be able to look at the scary things, look at them straight on, talk about them, and that helps them lose their power. They're not so scary. It's not the elephant in the room that no one is talking about. One of the other things we help people think about is learning to accept uncertainty, learning to accept that uncertainty is the name of the game, and the truth of the matter is that it always was, even before your cancer diagnosis. You just didn't think about it that way. Now that you've been face to face with something this scary, the idea of uncertainty seems so much bigger, but it's always been there. So learning to accept that we don't have a crystal ball and we don't know what's going to happen in the future is a really important thing. It doesn't always mean we can feel comfortable with it, but it does say we don't really have that much power over it, so we're going to have to learn to live with it. One of the other things that I wish I didn't have to say to people is that you're going to have to teach people around you how to wait and be patient, that this is not a time where you just rebound. Some people do, but most people don't. And it's not the thing you want to tell your wonderfully patient spouse who's been sitting next to you and coming to every single appointment, that you want to say, oh, by the way, it's another year or so before I'm really going to feel good. You don't want to say that. But the fact is that this is part of the cancer journey. And you may have to teach the people around you to have patience. And then finally, of course, for you to have patience yourself. Some of the other coping techniques that we talk about are in the category of mindfulness. So this is something you've probably heard about many times. Some of you may be very familiar, and some of you may think, I've always heard about that, I have no idea what it is, but I don't think it's for me. But I'm going to give you a brief definition. Mindfulness means being awake to the present moment. It is about paying attention on purpose without judgment. So what's going on is it actually arises. It's the ability to be aware of your thoughts, emotions, physical sensations, and actions in the present moment without judging or criticizing yourself. That is key, without judging or criticizing yourself. Mindfulness invites a sense of curiosity about observing and experiencing each moment as it unfolds right here and right now. It's not a trance. It's not thinking positive thoughts all the time. It's not religious, and it's not exclusively Eastern. There are different kinds of mindfulness. One kind is guided imagery, where different apps, or you can be in a class where someone reads a narrative of a guided narrative of a place to help you sort of remove yourself and think about being in a place that you find peaceful and happy. Those can be 20 minutes long, and they can be 5 minutes long. There are relaxation exercises that are breathing exercises, body scans. Some of you may be familiar with this, and we're going to come back in a second and actually do a brief relaxation exercise, very, very brief. And then another kind of mindfulness technique, which you probably have heard about, some of you hopefully have had some experience with, is called cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT. And CBT is a form of psychotherapy that focuses on how a person's thoughts, beliefs, and attitudes affect their feelings and behaviors. One of the things we know is that the many unhelpful ways that people can think about things can lead to very troubling emotions. And this is a kind of therapy where you would meet with a therapist who actually gives you homework, helps you record the kinds of thoughts you have and then the feelings you have after the thoughts, and helps you modify those thoughts to more realistic kinds of narratives, and that will help you feel better. We have a tendency with ourselves to say, I should do this, and I should do that, and I should feel this, and I should feel that. That should is a really bad word, because that tends to lead to a place where we judge ourselves. And learning not to say should and see things as should helps us feel a lot better. So that's one example of a distorted thought. And that's one very small example of what cognitive behavioral therapy can be about. I want to stop for a second and have us just take a breath And Ashley is going to lead us through a very short body or relaxation exercise so you can get a sense of what this is about. These are things that you can do for a minute every morning. They could be 20 minutes. They can be you sit in the car and before you turn the ignition on, you say, I'm going to do this for 30 seconds. This is very simple stuff. So, Ashley.
So today I'm going to walk us through something called a mini relaxation. So mini relaxations are exercises that focus on your breathing and they help reduce anxiety and tension pretty much immediately. What's great about minis is that you can do them at any place at any time, as Julie mentioned, and no one will really even know that you're doing them. You can do them with your eyes open. You could do them with your eyes closed. Obviously, if you're driving, please keep your eyes open. When you're stuck in traffic, when you're on hold, when you're waiting in the doctor's office, when somebody says something that bothers you, there's really no end to when you can use a mini breathing exercise. So the way that you start is just by finding a comfortable position. Again, you know, feel free to close your eyes if you're comfortable in doing so. And when you start the breathing, try to focus on taking the breath in through your nose and out through your mouth. So what we think of as a deep breath. And as you're doing this, you should really feel your stomach actually rising and falling with each breath. And the way that you're going to start this mini is as you inhale through your nose, you're going to count very slowly up to four. And as you exhale, you're going to count slowly back down to one. So as you inhale, you say to yourself, one, two, three, four, or however slow you need to do it. And as you exhale, count back down and say to yourself, four, three, two, one. And you can repeat this as many times as you need, and as often as you need to. And just want to mention that the only time minis don't work is when you forget to do them. So this is a great tool that you can use throughout your day as a way to just bring yourself back into your body, to be a little bit more mindful, and to just take a pause for yourself.
So before we move to the next slide, I want to just say something more about cognitive behavioral therapy as part of mindfulness. And that is that the fear of recurrence at this point in time is often a very big thing for people. And what that often does is cause patients to have what we call catastrophic thinking, which means that if there is any sort of an ache or pain or some change in how you feel, that there's an absolute certainty that this is got to be a cancer recurrence. And what cognitive behavioral therapy does is help you recognize to step back and say, yes, my back does hurt, and it's hurt for a few days now. And I know I'm thinking that's got to be a cancer recurrence coming. I just know. Of course it is. My last time with the doctor a year ago when I had a pain showed cancer. When I was first diagnosed. So of course that's what this is going to be because that's my experience now. But usually that's not the case. It almost always isn't the case. So learning how to say, I think that I'm overreacting. I think it might be that I was lifting some furniture last weekend so my back hurts. Or I think it's that my dog pulled me really hard when I went on a walk the other day. And that's why my back hurts. Learning how to say there are alternate explanations for why I'm feeling what I'm feeling. That's not to say that there isn't a point in time where you do want to talk to your doctor. But obviously living every single day, going to that catastrophic place is a very uncomfortable way to be. And so cognitive behavioral therapy has a strong place in people's recovery. Along with all of these other things that we've talked about. So I wonder if you can guess what this conversation is now going to turn to. Well, we're going to talk about body image and sexuality. This is something that people don't really like to talk about. We have this culture that is saturated with sex, and yet people don't like to really talk about it when it refers to them. Nobody really knows who should start the conversation, and there are so many assumptions and so much misinformation and so much anxiety around sexuality, especially after you go through something like you all have just gone through. So here are some information that I think you'll like to hear, in some sense like to hear, at least it will be validating. Greater than 50% of women report sexual problems after treatment for breast cancer. Greater than 50%. That's a big number. Changes in body image and changes in sexual satisfaction occur very frequently after treatment for breast cancer. The changes happen early, and they don't go away on their own. They tend to persist, and they tend to worsen if they're not treated. But here's the good news. There is treatment. There is a lot of treatment. And it's really important to ask to bring this up. Many people will say, I don't want to talk about this because, look, I'm just lucky to be alive. Why should I worry about sexuality? Why should I worry about sex at all? I'm just happy to be alive. Well, guess what? It's part of life, and it's part of quality of life. And it's really important that you bring it up. One of the other things that often will happen is, if you don't, the symptoms get worse. That's one thing. But secondly, anxiety increases, depression can increase. And it also is one of the leading reasons that people will stop their hormonal treatment early, because they feel that the hormonal treatment is contributing to their sexual problems, and they don't know how to fix them. So it's really important to bring it up. So here what you see is, someone who just doesn't feel like they're in the mood. So libido is a big problem that I'm sure many of you have said to yourself, boy, I think I've heard people say to me, you know, I'm closed for business. I've made that very clear. Or they say, I feel like I've been neutered. I have no desire. I have no sensation. And it's a very common feeling. And it's a very sad feeling for many people, because it means that part of their life that was so important to them seems to be gone. And there's a sense of guilt that they're even worrying about it, and then there's guilt that they're maybe keeping this from their partner. And so it's a very complicated set of feelings that people have. But what's happened to you over the last year and a half has contributed to all this, and it's really important for you to understand what's going on. Having treatment for breast cancer often leads to estrogen depletion. And that will come from surgical procedures, like your ovaries being removed. Hormonal treatments can do this. Chemo induces menopause often, early menopause for young women. Sometimes chemo will induce menopausal symptoms for women who've already had menopausal symptoms, and that's lovely too. You've also had body-altering surgery, which changes your feeling about your body, but it also changes the sensations that you have. Your sense of body integrity and what you see when you look at yourself. What happens physically, and I'm not a doctor, so we're just talking in a very general way, is that early menopause, any kind of menopause, leads to vaginal dryness and other issues vaginally, like elasticity is a problem, lubrication is a problem, and blood supply is a problem. So when we talk to our patients, especially in our group, which we have a lot of fun with, by the way, if you ever decide to come when we have this meeting about sexuality, is we make them repeat over and over again, moisture, stretch, blood flow. We make them, these are things that we have to work on with our vaginas. Moisture, stretch, and blood flow. If we don't, it leads to avoidance. And avoidance doesn't help anything. So how do we work on these? One, we talk to our doctor. If we don't get anywhere with our doctor, we find a gynecologist who specializes in this. Even before all that, there's one really important thing that people are always surprised to learn, and that is that you need to moisturize your vagina in the same way that you moisturize the rest of your body, especially after menopause. Even before is a good idea. I bet many of you who had not had menopause were moisturizing your skin, and it's the same. So there are actual products that are vaginal moisturizers that you use 3 to 5 times a week. These are not lubricants. That's a separate thing for actual sexual activity. These are moisturizers, and you use them 3 to 5 times a week, and it helps restore moisture. We have information that we can give you at some point that gives you some names of products. We also have a sexual health expert that can really talk to you specifically. This is her business. And so we can give you more information about that. There is actually, in terms of stretch, there are pelvic floor physical therapists that help you learn to stretch your vaginal muscles again, which have really retracted. And we can also help you learn how to get blood flow to the area so that the tissues are oxygenated. And without any sexual activity, what happens is there's no blood flow. And without blood flow, the oxygen is scarce, and tissues just tend to retract, and that's not good for your sex life. It leads to painful sex, and who wants to have painful sex? So it becomes a vicious cycle, and it's important to focus on this and also to ask for help, and most importantly, to realize that there are solutions to these problems. You can get this back. You just have to ask for help. So our goal today in general has been to help you acknowledge that you're in a period of recovery. We've touched on symptoms you may be experiencing in both the physical and emotional realms, along with some ways of finding relief. We've highlighted one of the most important and least acknowledged areas, body image and intimacy, with the hope of normalizing your experience and providing hope for improvement. Ashley, I'm going to let you close.
So just a few points that we want to reiterate and summarize, that recovery, we know, can be a long process. It's normal and it's expected that you might need several months or even several years to bounce back. Just wanting to remember that your feelings are normal, positive, negative, you know, anything and everything that you're thinking is normal, and we're here to support you, and the most important step is to ask for help from your medical team, from your friends and family, and just letting them know where you're at and what you're going through. So I'd like to close out our presentation today. We will have time for questions, but just wanting to share a story from a fellow social worker and breast cancer survivor. Her name's Hester Hill Shippen, and her book, After Breast Cancer, A Common Sense Guide to Life After Treatment, which is a book I highly recommend to all of you as you navigate this process, and I think it just summarizes our discussion today, and wanted to share it with you. So I'll read it now. It says, after completion of her breast cancer treatment, my patient went to Peru with her family. A highlight of their trip was a visit to the temples of Machu Picchu, the ancient Inca site in Peru. It was a warm day, and they climbed the steep temple steps with a group of American and Peruvian hikers. The American, she said, scrambled ahead and moved quickly and steadily towards the summit. The Peruvians lagged behind and periodically sat down to rest. One of the American men called down to them, saying, "What are you doing? We're trying to get a move on here." Their response was, "We are waiting. We need to give our souls time to catch up." Finally, we just want to close the presentation today with a few additional resources. The book that I just read from is listed here. And in addition, some programs and websites that have some helpful information as you navigate this process. You can find a resource to develop your survivorship care plan at one of the links listed below. There's also an additional website, Living Beyond Breast Cancer, and the Live Strong program at the YMCA, which I discussed in terms of your physical recovery. I also just wanted to mention that if you are interested in participating in the Facing Forward After Breast Cancer group, we will have our next cycle in fall 2019, and I've left my contact information here, so please feel free to reach out. I've also listed some resources that are offered here at Dana-Farber, including mindfulness, nutrition, exercise consults, the sexual health program, and our adult survivorship program with the corresponding numbers. And we'd be happy to provide you with any more information that you have about any of those programs that might be an additional resource for you as well. So now I think we have some time for questions.
Okay, great. So please, again, feel free to enter your questions as you think of them. Our first question for today is, I don't live close to Dana-Farber. Where do you recommend I find a counselor? I know what I'm feeling is normal, but it's a lot to work through.
Well, I'm glad you're asking, because that's a great question, and it's good to, I'm glad that you're thinking about looking for extra help. If you weren't treated here at Dana-Farber and you were treated someplace else, that's where I would start. I would ask your treatment center if they have ideas. If you were treated here, you can also ask us for ideas for counselors, and we can help direct you to place to people in your community who might be a good match for you. One of the other things I will suggest to people is that they go to their PCP, especially if they live in a rural area that's not close to any big cities. The PCPs tend to be pretty familiar with who the other providers are in the area, so it's another good place to ask. You can always call us. You can always ask us, too, and we can help you get started on your search.
A second question that we have is, how important is it that my counselor has experience with cancer patients?
Another really great question. I think it's really a personal preference. Obviously, you know, if you worked with a social worker during your time in treatment at Dana-Farber, they might have a recommendation for someone who has some experience with oncology. Sometimes I hear from patients that they feel like unless someone has experience working with someone who's had a cancer diagnosis, they can't really understand, and that might be true, but it's also important to explore with a potential mental health provider what you're really feeling, and if they're a good practitioner, they'll be able to walk you through all of the symptoms that you're experiencing and help you cope with them. And if that's important to you, it's okay to say that. It's okay to ask for someone who has some experience with oncology practice. But good mental health practitioners can also point you in the right direction and really help you work through some of the things you're feeling and experiencing.
Wonderful. So do we have any other questions from the audience at the moment? Okay. Well, thank you, everybody, for your time. So glad that you tuned in. Thank you, Julie, and thank you, Ashley, for sharing your time with us. We definitely appreciate everything you had to share, and it's definitely incredibly helpful as we move forward. So thank you, everyone, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.